Assalamu alaikum and welcome guys, how are you? I hope so you are fine and enjoying good. Today we will discuss about some HSE trainings which are very mandatory. In the last lectures I have discussed about the HSE tools, but today I have left one portion of the HSE tool which is regarding to the risk and hazard identification, accident investigation, and also it is all about the audits and inspections. These are the HSE tools which we will later on discuss, because I will discuss them with a relative case so that you can better understand how to do a risk assessment and how to conduct an accident investigation and how to do a audit inspection. So this will be in accordance to the relative cases for your easy understanding. Today we will discuss about the startup of the trainings, which are mandatory trainings and considered as a part of safety, because these trainings are very important. When you go through these trainings, you will also learn more about how to become a good safety officer. So now we go towards our lecture. This lecture is about the firefighting. What is a fire? First of all, the question arises, what is a fire? So as per the definition, it's a chemical reaction which comprises of three constituents. When these constituents come in contact with each other, so it will result in a fire. In this picture, you can easily see that there is a triangle shown. This triangle is called the fire triangle. In this fire triangle, there are three constituents. One is the ignition, any spark. The other one is the fuel, the source. Other is the air, which is present all around in our environment. So when these three things come in contact with each other, it results in a fire. Simple thing, you take an example of a home stove. What you do, the air is present, you switch on the gas for that oven and then lit a mastic. This mastic one lit, when you bring it close to the gas connection or to the oven stove, then what it happens, it results in a fire. This fire is a confined fire because it's just affect only, or it just come over there on the oven. But actually in the organizations, when you are working with multiple equipments, when you have lot of flammable gases, when you have lot of sources which can cause a fire, just like diesel, gasoline, oil. So when these products are not easily maintained, when these products hazards are not known, when you are doing the job in an unsafe way, so these types of things will lead to the fire. In the organizations where there is a lot of combustible fluids present, there is a special care which is taken against the fire accidents to happen, and the control measures are implemented to prevent any kind of a fire. Because when the fire erupts, sometimes it restricts to a specific area, but sometimes it spreads. When it is spread and uncontrolled, so most of the things in the organization, they burn. Most of the people who are working over there, they have got burn injuries, and maybe the situation become more severe and it leads to multiple fatalities, equipment damage or catastrophic scenario. So when we are working in the organization, we need to take care of the fire accidents, because many of the things are involved in our environment which can lead to the fire. First of all, we go towards the classification of the fire according to the type of the materials, and it is a standard classification which is shown in this table. Class A fire, class B fire, class C fire and class D fire. What is a class A fire? Class A fire occurs from wood, rubber, paper, plastic, ordinary materials which are ordinary in nature. When these materials become the source, air is present and the ignition comes, it results in the fire. Why these classes of fires are designed? Because there is a different extinguishing media, different fire control facility which is used against different type of fire. So they first have they already classified the fires in different types, and then they classify the type of the extinguish media against each of these class of the fires. Second one is called is results from the combustible fuels, diesel, gasoline, gaseous emissions. They come from this type of materials. This type of fire, class B fire, comes from these type of materials. Then we come towards the C type. The C type results from the electrical failure. You have electrical equipments in your home, you have electrical equipments in your organizations. When these electrical equipments are not managed properly, for example, you have an electrical connection, but this electrical connection is not proper, not certified. You have not certified electrical equipments. So what happens if there's some short circuit comes? This short circuit results in the heating of the wire, and then it results a spark, air, oxygen source. Three things are present. The fire erupts. So class C type is very dangerous. When you are in the home, when you are in the organization, you are using electric appliances, make it sure the electric appliances are properly connected with plug and plugs. They have proper connections. There is no short circuiting. There is no uneven connection. There is no tripping on the ground for this electrical wires. There are no extension cords which are leading from one place to another place, covering a long distances. There should be proper standard devices. There should be proper grounding of the equipments. So if there is some short circuit, and to prevent the person from an electrical shock, and to prevent the appliances from electrical short circuiting, which can lead to the fire accident. Now we come towards the class D. The class D fire results from the metals, sodium, magnesium. These type of metals can result in a fire accident. Nowadays there is another type of fire category which comes, which is called the K fire. K fire results from the kitchen. You are in the kitchen, you are using fire to heat up material, which just as like materials like oil. If you have some cooking and there is some oil, and it oil gets heat and gets a spark, the ignition, so it can lead to the fire accident. So this type of fire also exists. This is called the K type, and it is categorized as a kitchen fire. Why they are designed, or why they are categorized? They are categorized because they have different extinguishing media for these type of fires. DCP, this is called dry chemical powder. CO2 type of fire extinguisher, water, sand, and blanketing. These type of extinguishing medias are helpful in extinguish the fire. First of all, I will let you know how to operate a fire extinguisher, and then we go towards the detail of this fire extinguishers. But as I told you before, the different type of classes of the fire, they have the different extinguishing media. First media for the class A type of the fire, it comes as water, CO2, dry chemical powder, sand. You can utilize all these type of fire extinguishers when the fire results from these type of materials. Then you go towards the other type, which is combustible. Water cannot be used. DCP is used, CO2 is used. Water, why cannot be used? Because when you throw the water on the fire which results from the combustible fuel or the gas, this fire has a temperature of more than 1000 degrees centigrade. When you throw the water, it becomes a steam. Steam is much more dangerous than the ordinary water. So it leads to another case of an injury or to the personnel who is using the water over a fire resulting from a combustible liquid. Then towards, then it comes towards the electrical fire. Water we cannot use. Water is a conductor of electricity. If you use the water, then what happens? Then the person who is throwing the water over the fire, he can get an electrical shock. CO2 and DCP. The priority one is the CO2. Why CO2 is used? Because when an electrical equipment is damaged, maybe one part of the equipment is damaged. So you can use the CO2 to extinguish the fire. But if you use the DCP over that, what happens? the DCP has a powder inside. Why it is called that? That's why it is called dry chemical powder. There is a dry chemical inside this one in the powder form. So when you use this one DCP on the electrical equipment, it will throw the powder on the electrical devices. So these devices will get rusted because of this powder, of this chemical powder inside. The CO2 is the gas it removes after some time from the electrical equipment. That's why in the priority you have to use the CO2. If you don't have the CO2, then you have to go for this option, because you have to extinguish the fire. This is your main response. Now we come towards the DCP and the CO2 fire type of extinguisher. What is DCP, dry chemical powder? There are some physical evidences, visual evidences from which you can understand that which type is the DCP and which type is the CO2. First of all, we go through the dry chemical powder. This fire extinguisher has a hose, a trigger, a pin, and a nitrogen gas cartridge which is inside the shell, and it is filled up with the powder. There are different kgs of the fire extinguisher for DCP: 3 kgs, 8 kgs, 6 kgs, 10 kgs, and so on with the category. Some are with the trolley. There is a trolley and one big fire extinguisher with 30 kgs, 50 kgs. So the second one is, and the one thing, most important thing, which is the visual evidence for this DCP, there is a gauge inside this cylinder. This gauge shows the pressure of the gas cartridge. There are three types of sections in that gauge. One is the red one with the zero value, other one is the green one, and the third one is the overcharge. When it comes towards the down one with the zero red, the needle goes towards the red, it means the gas is removed. This gas, why there is a gauge inside this cylinder? Because this gas works. When it gas works, it brings out the powder from this hose. So when there is no pressure, the powder will not come out from the fire extinguisher. So we utilize a gauge in this one to show the pressure of the gas. The green one is the current status and the healthy status of the fire extinguisher. Red one is that it cannot be utilized. The other one on the right hand side, and it is showing the overcharge. It means there is a chance that the gas has extra pressure inside and it has a chance of explosion. So just try to make it show that these things are being followed. The gauge is being checked, and the safety officer have to do a monthly inspection for this fire extinguisher to make it sure that all the things which I mentioned, the hose is okay, the pin is okay, it is not removed, the triggers are okay, the outside shells of the cylinders are okay. Second one comes towards the CO2. These two types of extinguishers are majorly used in the organization. The CO2 has a CO2 cartridge inside, have a pin, have a trigger, and have a horn shaped hose. When you see a horn shaped hose, it means that this is a CO2 fire extinguisher. And also there is no gauge on the CO2 fire extinguisher. Why there is no gauge inside? Because the gas, CO2 is a gas. When the gas is anywhere in a closed container, it has some pressure. So at any time it can work. It can, if there is a small leak of the gas, it can work for some time where you require it for extinguishing a fire. Then we go towards this rule for the fire extinguisher for extinguishing a fire. This is called a pass rule. This pass rule is a combination of four words. First word is P, stands for pull the pin. There is a pin. I have told you that there is a pin inside. If this pin is intact, the trigger of the fire extinguisher will not work. When you pull out the pin, the trigger, you can squeeze it easily. A stands for aim at the base. Remember one rule: when you have this hose in your hand, do not keep it on the top of the surface of the fire. You have to point it down towards the ground, towards the source from where the fire is erupting. Okay. Then S stands for squeeze. When you pull out the pin, you can easily squeeze the trigger. The powder comes out, the gas comes out from that hose. Last S stands for sweep. What means sweep? Sweep, you have to not keep this nozzle at the same point at one location. You have to move the hose towards both the directions in 180 degree. Why? Because you need to extinguish the fire on that area. Now there are some rules which we will discuss. These rules are very important when you are fighting a fire. First rule is that if you see the fire is small and you can utilize this fire extinguisher, because these fire extinguishers with the value works with some time. This DCP works for, if you have a DCP of 8 kg, it can work for just 10 seconds. CO2 is the same. So if you think the fire is in a small area and it can be extinguished using a fire extinguisher, then use this type of fire extinguisher. Otherwise, what you need to do, you need to evacuate yourself. Second rule is that if you don't know what is burning, you don't know how to extinguish it, then you do not go for it. Do not try to fight with this fire using maybe this source of fire is electricity and you put the water on it. You can get an electrical shock. The third rule is that if your sixth sense is telling you that this fire is dangerous and spreading, you need to evacuate yourself. Don't need to fight a fire. If you do not know, the fourth one is that if you do not know what type of the material is burned, you have to evacuate yourself. If you inhale some toxic gas, immediately evacuate yourself. And the last one is what? If you are extinguishing a fire, do not stand in front of the fire. Keep your back towards the door, because if something melt and drops down, your way of escape will be covered by the broken material, covered by the dropped materials. So you need to make sure that you have an easy access to outside or to the exit. When you are, if there is a fire in the building and you are moving yourself out, just make it sure to close all the windows and the doors. Do not lock the doors. Maybe some person is inside, he cannot approach. If you lock the door, he cannot move himself outside. In the buildings, when you have a fire extinguishing alarm which rotates and which rings and make a sound, what you need to do, you need to use the ladders, not use the elevators to go down, because if the electricity shut down, you will still remain in the elevators. The stairs are the priority way to utilize to go down towards the emergency. So these are the rules which are very mandatory, and you have to follow these rules. Then we come towards the emergency response. If you see a fire, the first response is to that, make a sound, shout, help, help, and fire, fire. Then second, you have to go for the activation of the emergency alarms. There are manual alarms and the electrical alarms. In the organizations, they have alarms which when you activate, make a sound. So that other persons who do not know about where is the location of the fire, they also become conscious and evacuate themselves and call the emergency team to come over there to cope up with the fire. So this is your emergency response. The last one, the statement is that do not panic. If you panic in that situation, I know that when this type of situation happened and most of the area is covered by the fire, so you get panic. But if you get panic, what happens? If you know about how to use this thing, if you know about how to do an emergency response, all the things will be mingled up. You will be confused. You cannot attend yourself. You can attend, even though you cannot save your fellow men if you have a chance to save them. So in that type of emergencies, when you have a fire incident, any kind of emergencies, the main thing is that you do not need to panic. If you panic, all the things will go down. Maybe you become a victim. Maybe you come in, you cannot escape, evacuate yourself properly. You cannot do the emergency properly. So when you are fighting the fire, just make it sure. Or when this type of accident happen in your organization, just make it sure, first response, and just make it sure the things you are being trained. You have to do the dry drills, emergency drills, mock drills, to make it sure that you are enough practiced to fight a fire. But the rules which I have told you, you have to follow these rules first, because there are many firefighting organizations which deal with the bigger fires. You have in the organizations fire hydrant systems which can perform, or the fire team which can respond to the fire if it happens in any specific location. So this is the whole about the fire. training, fire safety training, and I have discussed major things and in details and in brief also for your information, that whenever you are working in an organization as a safety officer, you have to train your employees. And if you are working as a fire coordinator, you need to know how to make a fire team, how to do an emergency response, how to cope up with the fire in case the fire is spreading, something like this, the event is becoming catastrophic. You have to follow these rules. So this brief discussion will help you out in the organizations. Even though it will help you in your in any case of emergency response, you have to make it at your home. You are driving the car on the road. If your car gets fire, so this will help you out. Thanks a lot, guys, and response me back with the questions so that I can reply them properly. Thank you.